So let me start by doing what almost everyone has done and thank the occulture and Rebecca especially for such a wonderful incarnation of tuning speculation. I was one of the people who was actually at the very first tuning speculation conference and have been at all of them except last year. And for me, this conference has made all the difference in my own creative and research life. So I want to thank Rebecca first and the occulture second, and all of you for coming today. Thank you so much. Those of you who know my work a little bit know that I like to combine different things. And yet I am a philosophy professor, and so I'm rather staid in how I combine things. Today I'm going to combine three things that I probably never would have dared talk about if it hadn't been for tuning speculation meetings. So here goes, and I'll try to be as quick as I can. One. Oh, it's called, by the way, Becoming-Cicada-Becoming-Imperceptible towards a hermetic account of music. Part one, two hermetic claims about music. The foundational text of the occult traditions of Europe is without question the collection of 17 short treatises that goes by the name Corpus Hermeticum. These texts, preserved in an Egyptian Greek from roughly 120 to 300 CE, offer a variety of teachings that intersect with the occult practices of astrology, alchemy, spiritual magic, and astral projection, but also elaborate philosophical principles articulating a variation of the great chain of being and providing the basis for a process of deification. Perhaps most striking and most disappointing, particularly in the context of our gathering here in the name of auscultation, occultation, is that these texts have almost nothing to say about music or sound. Indeed, the most substantive reference to music, do I have to worry about this? I guess it's just gonna put itself to sleep, I'm sorry. Indeed, the most substantive reference to music in the broader context of the Hermetic texts is found in the Latin Asclepius, a somewhat later compendium of ideas largely derived from the Corpus Hermeticum. Here, Hermes Trismegistus, the thrice great Hermes, the reason we call this tradition Hermetic, decries the incomprehensible corruption of pure philosophy by music. Knowing music, says Hermes, is nothing more than being versed in the correct sequence of all things together as allotted by divine reason. By divine song, this sequencing or marshalling of each particular thing into a single whole through reason's craftwork produces a certain concord very sweet and very true. Unquote. If it's an understanding the harmony of the spheres you want, better turn to philosophy than to listen to any divine song, no matter how lovely. There is, however, a far more intriguing discussion of music and sound to be found in the very last of the Greek treatises of the Corpus Hermeticum. It's probably telling that this treatise, which goes by the rather Gnostic title On the Soul Hindered by the Body's Affections, has been dismissed by most scholars of the Hermetic texts as a late compilation of incoherent fragments bordering on the unintelligible. So I thought it would be perfect for us. Fragmentary and incoherent though it be, Corpus Hermeticum 18 makes two astonishing claims about music. First, in a curious discussion of the special challenges of bringing, quote, harmony out of a piece of music played on many instruments, unquote, and I'd love to know what the reference there is, Hermes insists that the real problem here is that musical instruments are inherently prone to defects, so that instruments themselves are, quote, a hindrance to greater beauty by hindering the musician's rapport with the music. The clear consequence of this claim is that the greatest beauties achievable in music might be discovered along the path of becoming imperceptible. So that Hermes is here echoing Heraclitus's insistence that hidden harmony is better than obvious harmony. Second, in a particularly fragmentary and elliptical passage, the Greek is really hard, Hermes describes a performer who, quote, readies himself for a composition of great genius, and even without playing his lyre, somehow uses himself as an instrument, thereby turning something deficient into something magnificent, unquote. In an apparent attempt to clarify his meaning, Hermes goes on to give a striking example of something similar. Quote, "They say that a certain player on the kithara, dear to the patron god of music making, once entered a contest of singing to the kithara. But when a string broke, he was hindered in his exertions until his dearness to the mighty one restored the string for him and granted him the grace of fame. In place of the string, a providence of the mighty one caused a cicada to light upon the kithara and restore the song by keeping the space where the string had been." Thus, the kithara player won a victor's reputation when his string was mended and his grief came to an end, unquote. Here, the grace of fame comes to the musician whose broken string becomes a cicada. Could there be some occult link between becoming imperceptible and becoming cicada? Part two. A much more serious part. Sonic border, frontera sonora. Mexican composer and artist Guillermo Galindo, and now we really want the image, recently collaborated with the American photographer Richard Misrock on a project with the general title Border Cantos. In counterpart to Misrock's large-scale photographs of the southern border of the United States, with its array of walls and fences, remote desert landscapes, and blighted urban areas, Galindo has created experimental musical instruments made from the detritus both of human migration and of the militarized attempts to stop this migration. From other bits of detritus, used targets from shooting practice, migrants' clothing, and mappings of human remains in the desert, Galindo has constructed graphic scores on the basis of which his instruments can then be played. Here, for example, is the huesocolio, a simple zither made from vertebrae found on the Texas border and played by discarded chopsticks and toy cockroaches. This is just a tiny little musical sample. No idea what the volume's going to be. Ah, there's no volume.
Oh, it's not plugged. Is it?
Did it come in? No, it's plugged in. Oh, maybe the other speaker's on?
Oh, yeah. Maybe just...
Definitely want to hear this.
Yeah.
Let's see.
Maybe the source.
So that was the huesocordio. And here is the tortillafono, that is to say the tortillaphone, a mallet and string instrument made from the discarded metal cap of an electrical box from the failed Secure Border Initiative surveillance program. Galindo himself describes his instruments as, quote, meant to enable the invisible victims of immigration to speak through their personal belongings, unquote, while also allowing objects of aggression, as he says, to be given a new life and an opportunity to speak in their own terms. Elaborating his creative process, he argues that, quote, reappropriation, renaming, and reusing have always been important strategies for cultural survival for the conquered and oppressed. Imagining the world and recreating it in one's own terms is the first step for self-acceptance and liberation, unquote. Commenting on Galindo's work more generally, Josh Kuhn has argued that his graphic scores, quote, take John Cage's general bid for scoring music as an agent of human freedom and apply them to the very specific geopolitical map, a very specific moment of human urgency, unquote. Building on Galindo's claim that Mesoamerican instruments were talismans between worlds, Kuhn suggests that Galindo's instruments, which he generally calls activators, reactivate what has been erased through performances of sonic imagination. The freedom of aesthetic imagination then effectively destroys precisely the border that necessitates the exercise of this freedom. As Kuhn notes, quote, part of the common sense of border life, a belief shared by local residents, border patrol agents, and migrants alike, albeit from often radically different points of view, is that there is no such thing as the border. There are only borders. There is no line between the US and Mexico, us and them, north and south. There are only lines that bend and curve, start and stop, proliferate and vanish, both impenetrable and ready to be dismantled. I can only ask, is it fair to say that there is something hermetic in plastic cockroaches becoming music, and in the great wall of the southern border becoming imperceptible? Okay, part three. This is the longest part, and I'm going to read it faster, but I think it will be familiar to everybody. It's or somewhat familiar to everybody. It's called Becoming Imperceptible and Hecaeity. My invocation of becoming imperceptible is, of course, a pretty flagrant hint that my argument is veering over into the territory of Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari's dazzling philosophical masterpiece, A Thousand Plateaus, which I'm by no means alone in seeing as a kind of contemporary corpus hermeticum, and see the work of Joshua Ramey, for example, which I don't think is very good, but see that. Becoming imperceptible is a central theme of the 10th and longest plateau in A Thousand Plateaus. This is called 1730, Becoming Intense, Becoming Animal, Becoming Imperceptible. With the exception of the first and last plateaus, each title of A Thousand Plateaus begins with a date, sometimes quite precise, sometimes rather loose. The date here, 1730, alludes to the height of the European vampire craze and emphasizes that the chapter is about the kind of becoming involved in a human's becoming a vampire, a child's becoming a wolf, or a man's becoming a woman. More generally, the plateau is largely about modes of transformation or transmogrification and forcefully pursues a vision of the real in which all points of reference are called into question in a generalized becoming, a flux of becoming more Heraclitean than Heraclitus that blurs the boundaries of all subjects and all objects, that undercuts any semiotics relating word and object, and that folds all modes of alleged transcendence back into a plane of immanence or a plane of consistency that is profound precisely to the extent that it's utterly flat. The issue at stake is then becoming itself, and Deleuze and Guattari effectively take us back to the archaic Greek thinkers who worried about motion and change and wondered what it could possibly mean for one thing to become another thing. This is only possible, Deleuze and Guattari argue, on the assumption that, quote, a becoming lacks a subject distinct from itself. And here's a quote, what is real is the becoming itself, the block of becoming, not the supposedly fixed terms through which that which becomes passes. Becoming can and should be qualified as becoming animal, even in the absence of a term that would be the animal become. The becoming animal of the human being is real, even if the animal the human being becomes is not. And the becoming other of the animal is real, even if that something other it becomes is not, unquote. What is real is the becoming, not the starting point or end point of the process. There's no subject undergoing change in the course of becoming, nor is there an object into which that subject might have been changed. There's only the flux of becoming animal, becoming other. Becoming and thus becoming imperceptible presupposes a distinctive, quote, mode of individuation, the Deleuze and Guattari call hecaeity, borrowing the term from Duns Scotus, but transforming its meaning quite radically. Where Scotus uses the notion of hecaeity to explain the individuality of a particular thing constituted by a host of qualitative properties, they insist that hecaeity is, quote, a mode of individuation very different from that of a person, subject, thing, or substance. Quote, a season, a winter, a summer, an hour, a date have a perfect individuality, lacking nothing, even though this individuality is different from that of a thing or a subject. They are hecaeities in the sense that they consist entirely of relations of movement and rest between molecules or particles, capacities to affect and be affected. An hecaeity in this sense is characterized by a durational notion of time, as opposed to a moment or an instant, and a thousand plateaus borrows from Deleuze's logic of sense to contrast ion and chronos as two different modes of temporality. The difference here is between the indefinite time of the event and the time of measure that situates things and persons, a contrast that resonates, as Deleuze and Guattari repeat a number of times, with Pierre Boulez's distinction between non-pulse time and pulse time in music theory meant to describe contemporary developments in electronic music. I'm going to skip one a little bit. Deleuze and Guattari finally admit that becoming imperceptible means many things. Quote, what is the relation between the anorganic imperceptible, the a-signifying indiscernible, and the a-subjective impersonal, unquote? We see in this question one way in which the flattening of subjects and objects, the dispersing of a consciousness, the pressing of a flower, in the plane of immanence, a flattening characterized by the semiotic of hecaeity, is itself a prime instance of becoming imperceptible. Becoming imperceptible is something becoming intermixed with something other in some durational period. For example, some Gilles becoming riding with some Félix in the 1970s. But each instance of becoming imperceptible is effectively indiscernible from any other instance, with the net result that becoming imperceptible is really a matter of, quote, to be like everybody else, unquote. What this means is that any account of hecaeity fundamentally expresses the content becoming everybody, everything. Last part, the promised towards a hermetic account of music. Bringing together the suggestions of Hermes Trismegistus, the sonic imaginings of Guillermo Galindo, and the theoretical modeling of hecaeity found in Deleuze and Guattari, I'd like to close by sketching four basic principles of a hermetic account of music. And now I'm being very didactic. First, music is best approached as a privileged instance of the concept of becoming imperceptible. This is, of course, precisely what Hermes tells us in the last treatise of the Hermetica, but it's also implicit throughout A Thousand Plateaus. More poignantly, this is precisely what we hear in Galindo's Hueso Cordio, where talismanic vertebrae and toy cockroaches invoke the sound of imperceptible crossings between worlds. Second, because becoming imperceptible is the very heartbeat of any form of change, music is essentially evocative of transmogrification. There's always something uncanny in the indeterminate duration of a musical hecaeity, in the formless form of every sound-shifting process. In the Corpus Hermeticum, this uncanniness is reflected in the fact that what we call death is nothing but, quote, the dance of the passions of the cosmos, swirlings and concealments. The swirling is a return and the concealment a renewal, unquote. That's literally from the Corpus Hermeticum. What this means is that the cosmos is omniform. The musical hecaeity is effectively a becoming everything. We hear this too in Galindo's musical Activators, where the remains of a surveillance apparatus, itself designed to detect everything, becomes a tortillafono, a tortillaphone, plucked and struck into something strangely particular and yet utterly indeterminate. Third, yes, but no. Third, the transformations characteristic of music participate in the becoming imperceptible of formerly perceptible durational hecaeities. And this means, as Corpus Hermeticum 11, which is called Mind to Hermes, reminds us that becoming and time are simultaneously changeless and full of change, that music can only be experienced in the paradoxical inconsistency of the plane of consistency. Even as the plastic cockroaches dance on the soundboard of the Hueso Cordio, they also drop off the instrument and make their way across the table supporting the instrument till they drop off into the abyss. There's a video of that if you look it up. Fourth, music as becoming imperceptible is itself a privileged instance of the work of the imagination, itself understood as that rhizomatic power that makes it possible to, quote, saturate, eliminate, put everything in, unquote. Rather than theorizing imagination, Deleuze and Guattari exemplify it in their pyrotechnic arguments and unexpected examples. But Hermes is utterly explicit in his account of the role of imagination, which is fantasia in Greek, in the process he calls deification. In mind to Hermes, incorporeal imagination is invoked as the power that allows us to understand that things are located in God in a way that has nothing to do with place. This means, it follows by some kind of logical necessity, that, quote, nothing bounds the incorporeal, that nothing is quicker nor more powerful. Of all things, the incorporeal is the unbounded, the quickest, and most powerful, unquote. And it goes on to give an example. In the same way that you can imagine yourself in India right now, faster than your command, so too you can, quote, make yourself equal to God, unquote. And it is only through this form of deification or becoming God that you can even hope to understand the nature of the divine. As we've seen, in a remarkably similar way, Galindo's instruments, scores, and performances are exemplary cases of the ways in which imagination can recreate the world and thereby serve as tools for what he calls self-acceptance and liberation. Much more could be said, of course, about each of these principles and about the way each reflects an aspect of the complex teaching of the Corpus Hermeticum, and for that matter, how each of them represents and reflects much that's been said this weekend. But I hope and trust that I've said just enough to spur your own philosophical and sonic imaginations. Thanks.